Achette Audio presents Behind Closed Doors, Why We Break Up Families and How to Mend Them, written by Polly Curtis and read by Penelope Rawlins, with Polly Curtis. Some names have been changed to preserve anonymity. Listen to the end of the audiobook for an exclusive interview with the author, Polly Curtis, and one of the book's contributors, Caitlin, whose name has been anonymised. Caitlin will discuss her experiences being investigated by social workers and how she now advises to improve the way they work with families.
Do you cry out in your sleep, all my failings exposed, gets a taste in my mouth as desperation takes hold, and it's something so good, just can't function no more. Love, love will tear us apart again. Joy Division. Open all doors, open all senses, open all defences. Ask, what were these closed for? LEMN SISSAY. Preface. In a country without the death penalty, separating a child from their parents is arguably the most draconian power the state has to intervene in our lives. In many ways, as devastating as a life sentence, because the effect of that decision lasts forever. Family separation creates a trauma that is passed down generation to generation in a cycle that narrows people's chances of thriving at each step in a family tree. It's very hard to break that cycle. The reality of separating a child from their parent in the moment that it happens is the stuff of nightmares. When my children were babies, I had a recurring nightmare that I couldn't find them. In the dream, their buggy would slip into a lake and they would be submerged in murky water. I couldn't see them. I would dive down again and again to try to find them. Sometimes I'd touch the buggy but couldn't drag it out. It was a physical, desperate, panicked feeling. As a child, I had felt something similar turning around in an open-air market to reach for my mum's hand and not being able to find it. I can still feel the hot rising terror, the tears welling up, feeling smaller and smaller the more I strained to see her through the crowds. I felt invisible without her. My 8-year-old described something similar to me. I get this feeling when I go around the corner and you can't see me, he said. His worried eyes told me that the feeling he couldn't describe was terror. The memory of those primal reactions returned when I watched footage from the US-Mexican border as the Trump administration enacted its policy of separating migrant parents from their children. Families split up by the authorities as punishment for their parents' efforts to get to America. The unspeakable cruelty of ignoring that most basic need to be with your family haunted the world, and it tested the limits of populist America. It had me waking in the night with the terrors again. These nightmares, both real and imagined, are something I never thought I'd see anything close to in the England that I grew up in. But the authorities in England now separate more children from their families than at any point since current records began in the early 1990s. We're one of relatively few countries that practice non-consensual adoption, or forced adoption as critics call it. We do it far more than other Western countries. Of course, we don't remove children from their families to punish anyone or through any willful cruelty. Rather, the authorities have a legal responsibility to protect children from abusive or neglectful parents. Social workers go into the profession with the very best intentions. They are, in many ways, the heroes of this story. But the system is stacked against them. The number of children being removed from their families has been steadily increasing to the current record highs. It wasn't planned, and no one, including those working at the heart of the system who spend their lives thinking about it, even really agrees why it has happened. At the time of writing, there are 80,000 children in care in England. One of the most senior judges in the family courts who led a working group to investigate the problem told me that his group of experts estimated there are around 27,000 children in the care system who, with the right help, should never have even come to court and could have stayed with their parents. We are removing too many children from their parents. We are not giving families a chance to stay together. It's an open secret within the system. A judge's decision to remove a child from their family involves a complex balancing of the state's responsibility to protect that child from harm against human rights laws that protect the right to family life free from state interference. But the dysfunctions within families aren't cured by separation. They are simply put on hold. While the trauma can make existing problems worse and entrench a profound distrust in the state that is then passed down through generations. If we hold up the decision of when to remove a child as a prism through which to view society, it exposes some intolerable truths. This is a system riddled with class bias and prejudice against different ethnic groups and people of different abilities. It is a system that punishes isolation, focuses its powers on marginalised vulnerable women, and dismisses and ignores fathers. Communities who are subject to the system know this, and it has eroded any trust that there was. There are parallels with the growing mistrust in other establishments and authorities that has been linked to the rise of populist governments across the world. But in this case, it strikes at the heart of families. This book returns to the idea of that prism as we unpick the elements that have led to the removal of so many children from their parents and families and understand what it tells us about the kind of society we live in. If the biggest test of a society is how it looks after its most vulnerable, then we are failing. The social contract between families and the state is now broken. The result is a battle of state versus family. We need to talk about it. But we also need to stop the cycle of removal and find a way to help families stay together safely. Investigating and researching for this book took me across England to Sunderland, Bradford, Leeds, Bristol, Birmingham, the West Midlands, and London. I spent days in the family courts watching the ebb and flow of broken families. I sat in people's living rooms and heard their stories. I went to France to meet the British man who pays for women to flee social services. And I went to New York to learn how that city transformed a system facing similar problems to England. I held a series of 8 public events bringing people together from across the system to debate what's going wrong and how it can be improved. This book tells the story of the systemic drift of our welfare state through the dramatic and moving stories of the people who experience it. Each chapter introduces someone who has been involved, the mothers, a father, a social worker, a lawyer, a judge and more, and draws a portrait from their perspective. Taken together, I hope their stories build the deeper understanding I strive for. Some of these stories might seem at times contradictory. I tell of dramatic interventions to whip a child out of their home and of years of failure to intervene and support them to stay there safely. What underpins both these extremes is the eroding of the state's ability to make the hardest decisions well. As this book was going to press, the tragic news about Arthur Lobinio Hughes's abuse and murder was reported, shocking the nation and instigating calls to remove children from their families faster. But we have a system that is both removing too many children and failing to save some of those most at risk. Both these things are true because we are not equipping our children's social care system well. They are two symptoms of the same problem and a breathtaking double failure of our state. In both these scenarios, the children separated too soon and those left behind, the prism reveals the worst failures of the state. In recent years, the focus has been on those left behind. Minds focused by the appalling failures to intervene to save children like Peter Connolly, known as Baby P. This book looks at the other, more hidden end, the slide into removing more children and the damage that does. It doesn't deny that there are still children like Baby P left in unsafe homes, but shows the other kinds of damage we are doing when we remove children suddenly and without trying to support them to live safely with their parents. The reality of removing a child can be as profound and violent as the family separations on the border in America. It is the horror of my nightmares. It involves unearthly screams and parents' panicked primal fights for their babies. But it can also involve the quiet wearing away of family ties, purely because we as a state fail to help that family to stay together. This is a system designed to balance a child's safety with their right to family life that has now drifted so far from its original purpose that some people are questioning whether it's possible to save it. I explore an alternative, a system built on a strong, supportive society and fueled not by process and defence, but by love.
Part 1. How it works. Caitlin's story. They didn't give me a chance. The rise and rise of child removals. Caitlin stands frozen, watching the scene unfold before her. She can't move. She can't breathe. She feels like she's in that dream when you open your mouth and you can't scream. Her toddler Adam is trapped in her partner's grip, his face pushed up against a wall. Footnote. Caitlin and Adam are given pseudonyms to protect their identities. The sharp edge of a wooden panel is cutting into his cheek and splitting his lip. It is starting to bleed. Adam is screaming. Even with his cries in her ears, Caitlin doesn't react. His eyes say more to her than the sound he is making. His expression is pure fear. Caitlin's mind moves too slowly to respond. She can't understand what she's seeing or how she arrived at this moment. She can't comprehend that the man she loves so much is hurting the little boy who is absolutely dependent on her for his safety. She can't fathom her own actions. Why is she not tearing this attacker away from her baby? The only thought she can hold on to in her head is a question. How is this our life? Over time, his campaign of abuse mounts. Caitlin avoids the house more and more. She hangs around at mother and baby groups at a local children's centre after sessions finish, chatting and making friends, putting off going home. She tells herself stories about how the bruises appeared. Adam was always an active baby. He did sometimes headbutt hard surfaces accidentally. She sometimes convinces herself that maybe it wasn't her partner doing it. But her little boy's behaviour is changing and telling her the truth. He stops speaking and refuses to eat. He won't sleep at night. When her partner isn't around, he has tantrums, screaming his name in terror. How Caitlin ended up terrified in her own home, suffering emotional and physical abuse, and now watching her son being hurt, was bewildering to her. She was 19 and a very lonely single mother when she fell in love with this man. She had had Adam when she was just 16, and his father was never involved. She met her new partner at a party. He bought her food and clothes and looked after her. Her son warmed to him immediately. As a young single parent without much support, her own mum was an alcoholic and had left the family some years before, she thought this man offered her love for the first time. It felt like he was taking over just when she was struggling to make her life work. She was grateful. He did take over. In increments, he invaded her head, undermined her confidence, and made her feel that whatever he did was her fault. At first, it was relatively subtle. He developed an obsession that she was flirting with a local pet shop worker, flying off the handle every time she came back from buying dog food. Then one time, he disappeared for 2 days, and in the argument on his return, he destroyed a room, punching through a glass window.
He started to control her spending to the point where she was squeezing her son's feet into two small trainers to avoid the expense of a new pair. By this stage, he was monitoring her wardrobe and her phone, policing who she could talk to. The aggression got worse. From punching walls, he began to punch her. But there was a colder menace to his abuse as well. He would refuse to talk to her or acknowledge her presence for days on end. This was almost the worst, the stony, threatening silence and withdrawal of the love that she had so craved. She chased harder, tried to please more and to make amends. The slide from savior to abuser was so gradual, yet so shocking, that she could hardly process what was happening. There was no moment when she realized she had lost control, just a steady campaign to take over her life. She made excuses. "He's just being a man, a typical man," she said of his jealousy. Blows landed on days that he was finding hard, she told herself. She began to question her own sanity and that it was even happening at all. But it was happening, and it was happening on a daily basis. And Adam was seeing or hearing it all. His attention then turned to Adam, first by criticizing her parenting and urging her to smack her son as punishment, something she refused to do. Then by taking on the discipline himself, which began in that moment with Adam's face pressed up against the wall, but was quickly followed by bruises appearing on his small body. The first time Caitlin saw her son being hit, a grown man's blow on his backside, it was punishment for having soiled himself, and it was just before a support worker was due a visit. The worker arrived in the aftermath, called social services, and they ordered a medical observation, which identified 33 separate bruises or marks on his body. An interim care order was made, a legal decision by a judge in the family courts that gives the social workers in the council powers to remove a child and place them with a foster carer. When they took Adam, Caitlin walked away in the same numb state of disbelief. The mind can play tricks in these traumatic moments, running parallel narratives. On one hand, the teenager knew what her boyfriend was doing and was just relieved that her boy was safe. On the other hand, her partner was so inside her head, controlling her thoughts, that she second-guessed herself. Maybe she was going mad. Maybe they were all accidents. Maybe this was an injustice. The result was that Caitlin covered for her boyfriend, explaining away the marks on her son's body. She kept covering for him until he turned on her and blamed her for the abuse. She ended up in the criminal courts with a suspended sentence for child neglect. And she was pregnant again. She covered for her abusive partner so much that even after she managed to leave him, she couldn't tell the social workers that he was stalking her and turning up wherever she went, because seeing him would add to the case against her keeping her boy. While pregnant, she was in the social workers' process of parallel planning. They plan for two scenarios where either a mother keeps her newborn or the baby is removed at birth. No decision can be made until the baby arrives, because there is no child to protect until after the birth. There was little support for her at that point, because the system is focused on protecting children. And with Adam by then in care, and her second son still in her womb, there was, the logic followed, no one who needed protecting at that point. The conditions were created for a slow, inevitable car crash. After she gave birth, Caitlin moved to a mother and baby unit. That's where the social workers came for Jason, when he was just a few months old. "We're going to take him now," the social worker said. Two taxis were positioned outside the building, one containing her possessions, one full of baby stuff. The second car pulled away with her little boy inside. A silence enveloped her, and with it, that now familiar sense of numbness, the dissociation from a trauma. She arrived at her new home to flowers sent by a friend. She was trying to arrange them, but for some reason she couldn't hold on to anything or steady herself. She realized she had collapsed on the floor, rocking back and forth, as she tried to stab flowers into the florist foam at the bottom of a vase. She couldn't feel anything other than the tilting of the room around her. A little while later, she met one of the other mums who had been at the mother and baby unit that day. She recalled a totally different version of events. Not of silence, but of Caitlin's screams that tore through the building and terrified every other parent within earshot. It's a sound Caitlin can't recall, but no one who heard it will ever forget it. To get to grips with why we have become a society that removes more children than at any time since current records began, we can think of the child protection system as a prism into the wider problems of the society it serves. Changes in our collective economic fortunes, public health problems, social norms, and political rhetoric all play out in the lives of families and the decisions made by social workers and the courts across the country every day. Caitlin's case is just one of many thousands that have been through the social services and court system in the past decade, and at an accelerating rate. During the past 10 years alone, the number of children in care in England has increased by a third to over 80,000 in 2020. We have quietly become one of the most interventionist states in the world. The number of children adopted from the care system annually has almost doubled from 2,000 to around 3,440 in the same time frame. Most people only hear about this when there is a catastrophic failure on the part of social services and a child dies in horrific circumstances. The deaths of Victoria Climbier and then Peter Connolly, better known as Baby P, were met by intense scrutiny, with the services that should have protected them taking much of the blame. It's well documented that interventions went up in the wake of those scandals. One London social worker tells me that the fear of another scandal of this kind is now embedded in the thinking and decision-making of social work departments. Some managers worry about that more than anything. But the increase in children in the care system predates both these cases and has been almost steadily rising since the current records began in the early 1990s. Those harrowing, high-profile cases triggered significant spikes in the line graph that documents this rise. But the overall trend is more long-standing and less well understood. In fact, it illustrates many of the forces that have reshaped society over that time. The biggest single risk factor in a child going into care is deprivation. Across the UK, children are 10 times more likely to be in care if they live in the poorest 10% of areas, as opposed to the wealthiest 10%. Social workers talk about a pincer effect of deprivation and austerity since the Conservative Lib Dem coalition government began its programme of spending cuts in 2010. Poverty has in fact flatlined in England over the period, levelling out after years of steady decline, according to research by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, while austerity has consumed local budgets and councils' capacity to support families effectively. Manchester has one of the most hard-pressed social services systems in the country. A study in 2018 found that 48% of under-fives had been referred to council workers, the highest rate in the country. One Manchester social worker told me, "Poverty is the number one issue. If people had a bigger house, more money, they could be okay. But that poverty can trigger something bad to happen. or stop your ability to weather something bad happening. Social workers describe how austerity has worn away the tools they have to support families, to refer them for support services, or spend the time with them that they need, leaving nothing but the nuclear option of taking them to court. Some of these services are now so rationed that parents fail to qualify for mental health support or help to escape domestic violence. Yet, in a cruel irony, that same mental health problem or abusive partner then becomes the reason their kids are taken into care. A family lawyer I spoke to in Bradford described a client desperate for her daughter to return from the residential care she had been sent to because of her mother's abusive partner. The partner is gone, but the 15-year-old is stuck in care because, while everyone agrees they need family therapy, none is available. The care costs £10,000 a month in social worker visits, foster care allowances, and the supervision they require. The cost of therapy would be a fraction of that. A 2018 study authored by the chief social worker Isabel Trowler warned that without services available to support families, social workers have few options but to initiate proceedings. The thin red line is crossed and families find themselves on a conveyor belt into court. And it's not just social workers saying this. Sir Andrew McFarlane, president of the Family Division of the High Court, in a speech ahead of taking up the position last year, warned that it was easier to take a child into care than to get them support. The language may be more legalistic, but the message is the same. It may properly be said that we have reached a stage where the threshold for obtaining a public law court order is noticeably low, whereas, no doubt as a result of the current financial climate, the threshold for a family being able to access specialist support services in the community is conversely very high. We are removing some children from their parents for want of timely mental health treatment. This alone is a monumental failure of the state and its relationship with its most vulnerable people. Poverty plays out in people's lives in different ways. Social workers talk of the toxic trio that leads to children going into care: substance abuse, domestic abuse, and mental illness. All three can affect anyone, but they are all more prevalent among poorer people and, as we will examine later on, more strictly policed. Some add learning disabilities as a fourth category. For Caitlin, domestic abuse and her own poor mental health were the predominant issue in her family's life. Social workers focus on these obvious problems, despite the fact that they are, in part, symptoms of a poverty that in itself is just too big to contemplate, too seemingly unmanageable. Meanwhile, different and more complex risks to children have emerged in local areas. Scandals in Rotherham and Rochdale exposed a hidden world of child sexual exploitation, and social services began to focus on their role in preventing it. Gang violence has drawn in younger and younger children, with the child protection system stepping in to remove young people from violent and dangerous situations. The number of unaccompanied asylum seekers has also risen, increasing social services responsibilities in that remit, particularly in council areas where those children arrive. Most people agree that poverty, austerity, and increasingly complex social issues affect the rates of children in care. Thinking of the system as that prism into wider society, and considering those problems, you could begin to wonder why, in fact, our rates of intervention are not higher. But the extent of these effects is contested. The story is much more complicated. As chief social worker, Isabel Trowler is based at the Department for Education in Westminster, where she advises ministers on the issues facing the sector. A quietly independent figure, her skills were honed reforming social work in the East London borough of Hackney. She urges me to examine the nuances of the debate and warns against simplistic narratives. Austerity might have affected the services available, but the increase in children going into care predated the beginning of the austerity cuts in 2010. You have to decide what's really going on. Everyone has a whole range of incentives to say and believe certain things. You hear lots of stories about increased poverty, reductions in public spending, complexity. I'm really skeptical that it's only those things. Trowler paints a picture of shifting societal norms and expectations. Smacking is no longer acceptable. Parents are now expected to speak less sharply and listen more intently to their children. We have seen a shift in what society is prepared to accept as a standard of parenting they can tolerate, she says. When that happens, that social shift, that ricochets into social work decision-making and court decision-making. If you look at history, abuse now was not considered abuse 30 years ago. Every so often, that shifts. There is a much lower level of tolerance for it. Trowler's argument plays out in the evidence. According to data published by the Education Policy Institute, since 2010, the number of children taken into care because of physical and sexual abuse has remained steady. Meanwhile, the rise in overall cases is being fueled by social workers increasingly recommending that children be put on a protection plan because of neglect or emotional abuse. And in many cases, the risk that they might face such abuse in the future rather than evidence that it has actually happened. The laws governing how the state can intervene in family life are set out in the Children Act 1989, which for three decades has remained unchanged as more and more children have come into the system. The Children Act states that proceedings should be pursued when a child is suffering or is likely to suffer significant harm. Two major things have changed in the 30 years since that law was enacted. First, the understanding of what constitutes harm. And second, a shift from interventions at the point of harm to an anticipation of harm. This is why interventions on the basis of physical and sexual abuse have remained relatively consistent, while interventions for neglect and emotional abuse have risen. An accelerator to that was the 2015 law that introduced the concept of coercive and controlling domestic abuse, shifting the understanding of what constitutes abuse from purely physical to psychological as well. As we've seen, the number of children in care has been increasing almost steadily year on year since current records began 25 years ago. There are multiple layers of causes driving that trend. Increased risk aversion driven by public scrutiny of decision-making in high-profile cases such as Peter Connolly, changes in how we recognize abuse and neglect, and a shift in attitudes to parenting. But the combination of this ideological shift with deprivation and decreasing budgets to support families has compounded those effects. Each element may be understood and justified in isolation, but in combination, the impact has been an ever-increasing rise in numbers of children going into the care system. This systematic shift in how we police parenting in England was not the result of any formal policy. It wasn't debated in public forums, listed in a party manifesto, or communicated in any meaningful way to the people who would feel its impact for years to come. Rather, it was a cumulative process of unintended consequences and drift in a system which has resulted in a very different society. We never intended to create one of the biggest systems of child removal in the world, one that costs the taxpayer £9 billion a year. We never set out to create a system that fuels mistrust in the authorities and then bakes that mistrust into the psyche of families for generations to come. But we have. The prism of the child protection system and what it shows us about how society has changed is the story of Caitlin's life. In the end, her children weren't permanently removed because of the physical abuse Adam had suffered at the hands of her ex-partner. He was long gone by then. Caitlin knows she was making progress, but therapy wasn't available at that point to help her. And looking back, she is left wondering if she would still have her children if she could have been helped to make swifter progress. Another factor that is likely to have counted against her is the hypothetical concern. There was also a future risk of emotional harm, that Caitlin might get into another abusive relationship and fail again to prioritize her children's needs. It's hard to compute this thinking, that a child could be removed from a loving parent to mitigate the risk of them getting into another abusive relationship with someone one day. Imagine how it must feel to know you could be paying the greatest price for something you've not yet done, or that happening in any other area of the justice system. But those are the thoughts Caitlin has to live with. My experiences tell me that there may well have been another issue making it harder for the children to stay with her. Caitlin had become an expert at masking her problems and convincing people of her worthiness to parent, and inevitably, that will have led to concerns that she might continue to see her abuser and hide it from everyone. That would lead to an impression that she couldn't be trusted to tell the truth about what was going on. She had initially covered for him, so gripped was she in his psychological control. But once she had escaped, even though she was being stalked by him, she could not go to her social workers for help. Imagine being the social worker, faced with a history of abuse, terrible mental health problems, and no resources to support Caitlin. Now, imagine Caitlin is lying to you, and you don't know what to believe. How would you assess the risk to the children? Caitlin was still seeing the children 4 times a week in supervised contact sessions. The court decided they were to be adopted permanently. In Caitlin's case, as she tells her story, you can picture the difficult process of balancing her needs against her children's. What the courts must decide is whether she has a chance to get to a point of parenting them well within a timescale that doesn't cause too much suffering along the way. This is the heart of the debate about whether too many, or indeed not enough, children are being removed from their families. It is fiercely political. At one end of the spectrum, you have those who argue we are removing children with too much gusto, such as the faith in families withered away. At the other end, you have those who argue we are still giving parents too many chances to change when the evidence shows that they rarely do. Should Caitlin have been given another chance to redeem her parenting? Or was the best interest of her children served by finding them a new, stable home and fast? Sir Martin Neri has spent a career navigating this debate and seeing its consequences up close. He ran the prison service of England and Wales between 1998 and 2003, then went into child protection as chief executive of Barnardo's. In 2013, he was appointed a special advisor to the then Secretary of State for Education, Michael Gove. He has conducted reviews of the adoption process and into residential children's homes and the reform of social work education. I interviewed him by phone at the beginning of my research. He argues that children should be removed more swiftly, without a delay in which permanent damage can be done. A good system would intervene much more quickly, he says. He describes how the system could get locked into supporting poor, sad mothers and trying to help them reunite with their child, but it all comes at a cost to that child. Of course, we shouldn't be casual about taking children into care. The thought of someone taking your kids away is second only to death, but that doesn't mean it's not necessary. There's a general view we have too many children in care. We are quicker to intervene with families, and that's absolutely right and in the interest of the child. He pauses, then adds, The system is not perfect, I know. I sometimes help parents who have lost their children. They have been able to convince me that a mistake has been made. Of course, the system gets it wrong. But you have to remember the hard evidence is that people who are left in harmful homes are profoundly damaged. Over the past 20 years, Nery has been an influential voice in an increasing political appetite for adoption. Tony Blair's Labour government began the work of advocating for faster intervention and swifter adoptions. Then, in 2011, Gove, the then Secretary of State responsible, introduced reforms to speed up the process of resolving childcare proceedings. His theory was fueled by Nery's argument. Children who are removed from abusive or neglectful homes, then quickly placed in permanent homes, do better. The evidence showed that children who bounce around in the care system fare badly compared to their classroom peers. They were more likely to fail their exams and leave school at 16. Then they were much more likely to go to prison, end up homeless, and ultimately, their own children were more likely to be removed in the future. Nery's thinking is backed up by the last 20 years of research into how early childhood experiences impact brain development and can dictate a child's future. The quality of care you receive, and on the flip side, the levels of stress you experience, can hardwire your brain for life, and difficult, if not impossible, to reverse at a later stage. On the positive side, brain development, and specifically the softer skills of resilience, grit, and confidence, are aided by the quality of interactions between a parent and a child from a very early age. One formative paper from Harvard University, The Science of Neglect, describes the serve and return interactions between a child and their parent. A baby smiles, the parent smiles back. Then a baby makes a sound and the parent returns it, building the foundations of conversation. One day, they find themselves playing peekaboo. If the responses are unreliable, inappropriate, or simply absent, the developing architecture of the brain may be disrupted, and later learning, behavior, and health may be impaired, the paper says. Much of the research that built this understanding was developed from studying the experiences of children who had been severely neglected in institutions in China and Romania. As the science behind the quality of parenting was developing, so was the understanding of the impact of severe stress in childhood. The term adverse childhood experiences, ACEs, was coined at the end of the 1990s, after studies which identified 10 categories of neglect and abuse that can have profound long-term impacts on a child's ability to thrive. They are 1. Living with an adult who threatens or humiliates you. 2. Being hit or slapped or injured by an adult you live with. 3. Sexual abuse. 4. A persistent feeling that no one is loving or supporting you. 5. Parental separation or divorce. 6. Lacking the basics of food or clothes. 7. Domestic abuse within the family. 8. Living with an alcoholic or drug user. 9. Living with someone who is suffering mental illness. 10. Having a household family member in prison. Children can experience one or two of these and still thrive, and they can survive more if they have received good parenting through the serve and return interactions that has helped instill in them an underlying confidence and grit to weather storms. But as the number and severity of these experiences increase, the greater the adversity that child is likely to face through their life. The American Nobel Prize-winning economist James Heckman summed up the grim impact of this roll call of experiences. Early adverse experiences correlate with poor adult health, high medical care costs, increased depression and suicide rates, alcoholism, drug use, poor job performance and social function, disability, and impaired performance in subsequent generations. The debate around adverse childhood experiences came on the back of the most famous research that underpins much of parenting theory now. John Bowlby, a British psychologist, developed the idea of attachment theory after growing up being cared for by nannies who would abruptly leave and only seeing his mother for an hour a day. Working in the 1960s alongside other notable psychologists, including Mary Ainsworth, Bowlby cemented the idea of the importance of close parent-baby contact in the early years for developing healthy relationships later in life. In the UK, the childhood well-being research paper further propelled this to the front of policy formation. That study sets out the four states of parental attachment: secure, insecure and avoidant, insecure and ambivalent, and insecure and disorganized. Hostile, rejecting and controlling parenting causes children to overregulate their emotions, feeling unlovable and displaying anxious behavior. These are the 23% with insecure avoidant attachment. Children who are insecure and ambivalent have parents who are inconsistent, unreliable, or neglectful. The children work harder for parental attention, but can mirror their parents' behavior by switching tactics to get the attention they crave. Around 8% of children without a clinical diagnosis of any kind display these traits. Children who are cared for by people who are frightening or dangerous develop disorganized attachment. They struggle to remain in command of their own behavior and reactions as a result. The same paper concluded that in the general population, about 15% of children fall into this category. But over 80% of children brought up in neglectful or abusive homes display these behaviors. A child's environment of relationships, particularly those with their caregivers, plays a critical role in shaping the development of their overall brain architecture, the report said. Very early experiences need to be rich in touch, face-to-face contact and stimulation through conversation or reciprocating baby babble. These stimuli encourage a deeply networked brain, particularly the regions which govern social aspects of life. Advances in the understanding of the impact of neglect and emotional abuse have informed the rise in children going into care. It is well reasoned that children should be given a permanent home quickly. The pendulum swung towards those swifter decisions, but it happened at a time that the alternative, supporting a family to stay together, was weakened by austerity. It became, in many cases, the de facto choice. Stability has become the number one priority in the court's decision-making, and they are judged in turn by how rigorously they stick to the 26-week target for resolving care proceedings. In the legal lexicon, this is known as the child's timescales. But no one ever added being separated from your parents by being taken into care to the list of adverse childhood experiences. Ultimately, the choice between the known risk of their homes and the unknown risk of removing a child is made blind. For Caitlin, who happens to be talking to me 7 years to the day after her sons were permanently adopted, the word timescale has a haunting resonance. She was told to write a letter to her children to apologize for not making the changes quickly enough. I absolutely hate the word timescales. I heard it so many times and repeatedly, but I didn't know how to make those changes without help. Once I had the right support, I could do it, but it was too late. Caitlin is now thriving, but will always be angry that the system didn't have the same urgency to support her as it had for her children. If it did, she might have got the help she needed in time for them to stay together. The clock was against her from the start. Even if a parent wants to improve and become capable of looking after their own children, their fate lies in the hands of authorities that often lack the funding to provide the necessary help. Throughout the 2 years of the court process, Caitlin had access to some therapy, but mostly CBT, cognitive behaviour therapy, which did not prove to be helpful. The therapist who she met right after the adoption, who she says was central to her recovery, later said she would have improved in 6 months had she had access to the right therapy at the right time. By that interpretation, her children were removed because of an institutional scarcity of support for Caitlin to change. The extent of people's capacity to change is disputed. There are those who argue that parents have historically been given too much benefit of the doubt, leading to their children bouncing around the system in and out of care for years, until the instability and repeated failure to settle has left them scarred for life. In this analysis, putting the child first means less tolerance of parental shortcomings and a more skeptical approach to their capacity to change. That's why a parent's upbringing is so hardwired into the decision-making process. As one judge noted in a published judgment, the risk of harm flows from the traumas which happened to the parents when they themselves were young. We are all the people we are because of what has happened to us throughout our lives, and these parents are no different. Change is demanded to be linear. You're in a bad place, you get some support, you improve. But the reality is that the changes families need to make don't tend to happen in linear ways. Drug addicts relapse, domestic violence victims forgive their abusers, and mental health is not always something you simply recover from. It's more often something that, if you're lucky, you can learn to manage. Studies expose the complexity of trying to assess a person's ability to change. Academics highlight three factors that impact the ability to change in relation to child protection cases. First, a parent's own psychology, their ability to conceptualize what's going wrong and their responsibility for it. Second, the external factors bearing down on them in terms of housing, employment, or educational problems. And third, their relationship with the professionals involved in their case. And then there's how these three factors interlock. In courts, emphasis is placed on the first of these, the parents' psychological dynamics. Evidence is made of their behaviour, their histories, their own experiences of the care system, of abandonment and of abuse. These behaviours are inherited and passed down. But for people who spend their lives trying to escape their past, to be forced to replay it can intensify their feelings of injustice. Caitlin doesn't deny that she made huge mistakes in her parenting. We often look for the perfect victim to illustrate these stories. Caitlin wouldn't necessarily make the grade for that case study. She knows she made mistakes that she is judged for, but she accepts that responsibility. In fact, at the time of her case, she was so busy blaming herself for what had happened, she didn't even believe that she had the right to be a parent. Now, with time, therapy, and a lot of reflection, she thinks there is responsibility to be shared. "They needed to get me away from my ex. There's always more that could be done, and sometimes you just need to hear the truth. If they had said to me, 'If you do not split up with him, you are going to lose the children forever because they are not safe,' I would have done it." Instead, Caitlin was punished. "Why was no one helping me? Why wasn't he suffering the consequences? Now it's about taking responsibility for all the mistakes I've made that has helped me heal. But I also need to be able to blame the right people for things. Blaming my ex for his part, social services for their part, and when I lied to cover up, I take responsibility for that. I know what I did was wrong, but I know that's not what posed the greatest threat to my babies. I know deep in my heart what has happened is unjustified. I wish I knew that then. I definitely would have fought. I just thought it was all my fault. Just entering the child protection system can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. Being watched changes your parenting. The moment when you give birth is the moment when you're supposed to bond with your child. I remember when I had Adam, I couldn't take my eyes off him. I'd stare at him for hours. But with my second, I didn't because I felt like they could take him at any moment, she says. The first 24 hours, I could not look at him. I fed him, changed his nappy. I still took care of him, but I felt like I wasn't allowed to love him. As we talk about Caitlin's own childhood, I mentally tick off the list of adverse childhood experiences I hear about. Her mother was an alcoholic, who herself grew up in care. More than half of women who have had multiple children placed in care were in care themselves. Caitlin wasn't, but only because her dad picked up the pieces. But she sometimes wishes she had been, because despite his best efforts, he just couldn't give her the protection she needed. This is the cycle that the care system creates, and one that is so hard to break. Social workers consider having been in care as a risk factor in suspected abuse or neglect. For Caitlin, even her mum saw it coming. When she, at 16, told her mum the news, the response she received was, "I knew you would get pregnant." Now, she questions this. If she knew that, why didn't she do anything about it? Caitlin consciously tried to do things differently. When she was a little girl, her mum threatened to slap her for blowing bubbles into her milk through a straw until it spilled on the table. When Adam did the same, she set some boundaries. He could only blow when the milk was halfway down the glass, so it didn't make a mess. Abide by that rule, and she would join in blowing her own straw and racing him to the top. It sounds stupid, but those little things made me think I'd be different. She was trying, in vain, to break the cycle. Place Caitlin's story against the backdrop of wider changes in society that were driving the rising numbers of children in care, and you see where it fits. The removal of Caitlin's children happened just as the political dial was shifting towards more interventions, to being less tolerant of the mother's experiences. It was at a time when austerity was biting into the budgets available to support Caitlin with her problems and help her become fit to parent. It also happened in the aftermath of the death of Peter Connolly, when social workers were under pressure to avoid risk. She vividly remembers one social worker saying to her, "Why should I believe you? Peter Connolly's mum lied." After the adoption order was made, the months and years passed in a blur for Caitlin, and she credits a handful of close friends and her clinical psychologist for helping her climb out of the abyss. She now works with councils and families to try to reshape social services and put families back at the heart of their solutions when things are going wrong. As she recovered, Caitlin realized that she wanted to work to change the system. But she also realized that if she went in all guns blazing, she would come across as another loud-mouthed, disgruntled parent. "I thought, if I'm going to do this, I need to be smart. I need to make friends with these people. I need to be in their pockets. I need to be doing things differently," she says. Caitlin has brought together a group of parents, social workers, academics, and psychologists to advocate for change in the system. They offer support to parents who are in the process of legal proceedings They consult with organisations within the care and social work sectors to include parents' voices in their strategies and processes, and offer training on how to co-produce services with families. The same councils that once labelled her not good enough invite her back in to help improve the system. I watch Caitlin in action facilitating a training day in the Swish King's Cross offices of Camden Council, with their panoramic views over the new Google HQ to the capital beyond. There are over 100 people, but Caitlin has a presence that makes them all listen. You know when she is in the room. Her eyes dart from person to person, working out the dynamic and how to navigate it. Social workers from all over the country are gathered to hear about the pioneering work at the Central London Authority. She hollers to get everyone's attention, chairs the panels, and keeps everyone laughing along the way. 10 years previously, a council recommended the permanent removal of her two children. She gets a sense of satisfaction from being able to walk into that building and command respect from the kind of authorities that once judged her. Caitlin now lives across the city near the banks of the River Thames. Her two-bedroom flat on the fifth floor is neat and homely. Her huge sofa swallows me up, and the views stretch out across the capital. She lives with Freddie, her partner of 3.5 years, who was training to be a social worker. He drifts in and out as we talk, checking in on her as she tells her story, appearing out of nowhere the first time she cries, as she recalls the day her son was removed. Caitlin still sees her boys twice a year for a few hours. She's private about the time they spend together. It's important to her and sometimes very difficult, affecting her mood for long stretches either side of their meetings. She knows that at some point they will turn 18 and have the option to dictate the relationship they want with her. Her main complaint is that the social workers and courts didn't do everything within their powers to keep her family together. They reached for the nuclear button, despite the fact that there was help that could have kept them together. But she also argues that adoption is considered a magic bullet that erases all the problems that came before, and she contests that. So much happens within the moment of the decision to separate a family, Caitlin says. Everything is done quickly so children aren't affected too much, but the children are affected regardless. Caitlin pauses, and then says something that reverberates around my mind for months afterwards. The system is not set up for people like me. People like me, meaning people who have been through oppression, poverty, people who have been discriminated against because of the way you look, the way you sound, the way you dress, because you're young, because you're black, because you're Asian, because of whatever you are. I always had social services involved in my life, and every time they failed me, from when I was a little kid. When I really needed them, they failed me again by sweeping everything under the carpet and saying, "You've done this, you must suffer the consequences." And I thought, yes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.